Good evening, Joe and Muhammad. Since this contest is for the final determination of the heavyweight championship of the world, in the event of a knockdown, you must take an eight count. The other man must retire to the neutral corner. Shake hands now, man. Return to your corner.
Two and go.
This is the first and the only unique camp for boxing. This is a real fight camp. First one is world of the kind, I can boast.
He's out! Oh my God, he's won the title back at 32!
And right here, whenever I get thirsty, I just keep pumping. And the nice clear water. Joe Frazier's not getting this good clear water. See, Joe Frazier's drinking that old city water.
Now he's giving Frazier a working over, and Frazier goes back for the first time.
That was the fight. That was the fight of the century.
So I built my own cabins for the fighters to stay in. Then we got these rocks right here. Trainer Angelo Dundee rock here.
It was his fun arena. It was his theater. It was the place where he could perform.
Frazier, Liston.
Tonight somebody will die at ringside from shock.
Now turn it up again. And that's full blast right there.
Oh, and now Cooper's left eye is really in a shocking state.
Got old antique wagon here to go along with the scenery and atmosphere here. We'll hook a horse up to this sometime and take a ride.
And I went underneath his body with a right hand. Boom, and I crushed him in the side.
If you can throw your camera right over there, that's my old antique log cabin.
Muhammad Ali, the greatest sporting icon of the 20th century. Absolutely no doubt about that. Anybody out there not heard of him? Hit me!
I was like, Daddy, stop hitting him. I actually felt sorry for Joe Frazier.
Joe Frazier! All right, get him out of here! You make me nervous, get him out of here!
This is Sam Cooke. As you can see, like me, he's awful pretty.
He didn't look at a white person and say, you are represent that, and you represent that.
Baba is a man who will take a stand. Baba won't take no
man. By me, a man who pays the salary of at least 50,000 men in Vietnam.
Just your name beside his name made you something.
Walk with him, really. Just walk him all around.
If he wants to mix, he'll go in six.
And if he keeps talking jive, I'll cut it to five.
Hold it. Hold it. Hold it. You're not that pretty.
He said Cooper hit me so hard, he didn't only shape me, he shook my relations in Africa.
Whatever I'm not supposed to do is what I go do.
You guys got to talk to the superstar. Remember that.
If you ever came into personal contact with Ali, he almost certainly beguiled you. Still does. I covered boxing for BBC Radio in the 70s, and I was in the company of the great man on a good few occasions. It was absolutely a wonderful experience. In 1974, I found myself in Zaire in the lead-up to his epic contest with George Foreman when he regained the title. And one day, I found myself interviewing him. I was in the company of several other members of the British boxing press corps at the time. And Ali was explaining to us how he was going to jab and move against Foreman. He was going to float like a butterfly and sting like a bee, how he was going to beat him. None of us believed a word of it. We all thought George Foreman was going to win the fight. And as it turned out, of course, Ali used an entirely different tactic to win that particular contest. But he was explaining to us how he was going to jab and move, and I was next to him with the radio tape recorder. And he was throwing this jab into my face, or started to do so, and I'd seen him do this particular trick before, and the recipient had always moved his head back like this, and Ali rather enjoyed that. And they used to blink and feel rather uncomfortable. I thought, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to try and keep my head still and not blink. throughout this little experience. And I did so, and he kept jabbing, and it was went on for some time, this jabbing and moving. I'm going to jab, I'm going to knock him out, I'm going to do all this stuff. And I kept my head as still as I could. And at the end of this, he sat down and started talking about something else, and then he suddenly turned back to me and said, "You ain't as dumb as you look." Now, at the time, he said that to a lot of people, but if he said it to you, it was a kind of acknowledgement of your existence. And it was a sort of badge of honor from him. And it was great fun at the time.
The winner by unanimous decision is Muhammad Ali.
Ain't a bunker. Ain't a bunker.
Tonight.
You know how great I am. I don't have to tell you about my strategy.
Ain't a bunker. In the birthplace of the Louisville Lip. A guided tour from the family.
That's the house, is it?
Bill, many, many happy moments, Lord.
Harry Carpenter and Muhammad Ali come face to face with the big ugly bear, the gorilla, and R. Henry. When We Were Kings.
If you think the world was surprised when Nixon resigned, wait till I kick Fulman's behind.
The Oscar-winning feature-length account of the rumble in the jungle in the heart of Africa.
Ali looked as if he looked into himself and said, all right, this is the moment.
George Foreman previews the film and the fight. In One Punch Too Many, the hardest fight in history.
I think the 14th round was as close to death as you can get in the ring and not kill somebody.
The disturbing story of the years that followed.
When Ali tried to touch his finger to the tip of his nose, he missed the target.
The life and times of the greatest.
This is the legend of Muhammad Ali.
The greatest fighter that ever will be.
He talks a great deal and brags indeed.
Of a powerful punch on blinding speed.
Ali's got a left, Ali's got a right.
If he hits you once, you'll be asleep for a night.
Bear! Been chopping trees. I've done something new for this fight. I done wrestled with an alligator.
I have tussled with a whale.
I have handcuffed lightning.
Throw thunder in jail.
Only last week, I murdered a rock.
Injured a stone. Hospitalized a brick. Man, I'm so bad, I make medicine sick.
There are two things that are hard to hit and see. That's the spooky ghost and Muhammad Ali.
Hey!
56 years ago in Louisville, Kentucky, Cassius Marcellus Clay was born. Of course, we would come to know him better as Muhammad Ali.
Would you like to tell me what you think of Cassius Clay?
Oh, I think Cassius Clay is a nice man.
It's a good feeling being from Louisville, Kentucky, and the baddest man in the world.
Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. That was him.
He has a big mouth, and he's always talking about himself, and I don't particularly care for people like that.
Man, and what kills it? I'm pretty. Look at me, man. Still pretty. Look like a little schoolboy.
I'm not only a fighter. I'm a poet. I'm a prophet. I'm the resurrector. I'm the savior of the boxing world.
I think he's cute.
I admire him. You know, I admire him for supposedly not too far from here. He took the gold medal and threw it in the river because of prejudice.
From Louisville, Kentucky, has returned.
From where I came, nobody knows. I come from a land where the poppy seed grows.
Louisville is just another mid-American city. All that singles it out, it's the birthplace of the greatest sportsman of the century.
You say I'm pure and then I'm dilutable. And once I'm in your blood, I'll make it but suitable. And I heard a old lady say, sing it on, son. She said, sing it on, son. She said, I lost my son.
No offense.
I'm kidding you. That's the house, isn't
it?
No,
many, many happy moments, Lord.
That yes. Little pink house there.
That's it.
That's where you were raised. You were raised there, and Muhammad Ali was raised
from
there.
From 4 years old, I was 5 years old when first moved here.
Well, the first thing I can remember is my mother and father walking down
this certain street looking for a house, moving into the house that I was raised in. That was the first thing I can really remember. I can't go back no farther than that.
Let me ask you, was life good here when you were born?
It was mixed. It was mixed. Because sometimes Dad would come in and have arguments with my mom and disagreements with mom. But that was all my dad's fault. Mom was an angel. God bless her soul. She went straight to heaven. He was a good man, raised by good, me and my brother, but he wasn't that good to my mom. Wasn't that true good to mom. Mm-hmm. But she stayed with him because of us. Mom said, the only reason I'm staying with you is because of my children. Love my children. I don't want to see them separated. So she stayed with Dad. He was a drunkard.
Mrs. Odessa Clay has some fond memories of her son. Can you tell me, Mrs. Clay, was your son a big baby when he was born?
Well, no, he was not a big baby, weighed about 6 pounds, 1 ounce, so I wouldn't call that a very large baby.
How quickly did he learn to talk?
He learned to talk before he was 1 year old, and he's always been a great talker.
Hold it, you're not that pretty.
I'm a bad man. Wait. I took up the world.
I think he could be a good fighter if he controlled his egotism and confined himself to serious training.
Here we are, sir. Here's the famous Columbia Gym. This is where Muhammad first began boxing. 1953. We come here in 1953. The golden years of our lives. Muhammad Ali was 12. I was 10 years old.
Well, at the age of 12 years old, 11 years old, I went to this big gymnasium hall where they were having what we called a home show. Left my bicycle outside. It was a rainy night, I remember, and came back. It was stolen, so I asked the man where could I find the nearest policeman. He told me a fellow by the name of Joe Martin, who's downstairs in Columbia Training Center.
You saw Mr. Martin. Joe Martin standing in the corner, and Muhammad Ali pulled his coat. Mister, my bicycle was stolen. I'm going to report it. He's an officer. He said, well, tell me all about it, son. And why don't you come back and box and beat up the guy that stole your bicycle one day.
We traveled all over the country and was very close together for a number of years. And I can honestly say I never heard him say a slang word in all those times. And we was out of town a lot for fights, and I don't remember of a day that he didn't read at least a chapter in the Bible before he retired at night.
Put the gloves on these suckers. I'm gonna show you how I play with these kids.
Keep working.
Now take my shots.
Ali, he was fun. He played and talked. The same way that he did when he was talking about the fighters and stuff. I can beat this chump. I can do this. He did the same thing as an amateur, you know. And then when we went to Chicago in the Golden Gloves, he would tell the guy, I'm gonna knock you out in one round. You're going in two. Something like that. But he was doing the same thing as an amateur that he was doing in the pro. But everybody thought it was something new, but it wasn't a new. I saw him do it before.
I predict that he will go in 8 to prove that I am great. And if he want to go to heaven, I'll get him in 7. He'll be in the worst of 6 if I cut it to 6. And if he keeps talking jive, I'll cut it to 5.
Me and this man used to box every day. He used to whoop me. Didn't I tell you I was going to come back one day? And act like you crazy and jump on up in there. Look like Joe Frazier.
Occasionally he talks out of turn, but he's got the boxing game a lot of publicity, which it otherwise wouldn't have, and he probably has people who would otherwise be indifferent paying to go see fights, and he's probably done the game more good than harm. That's what I would say.
How excited was young Cassius about going to the Olympics all those years ago in 1960?
He was excited as a newborn, a young child on Christmas Day. He said, Mother, Mom, I'm going over to Rome, I'm going to win the gold medal, come back home as the Olympic gold medalist champion.
And did you watch it on TV?
I watched it on TV. Matter of fact, I was so happy, I cried with jubilation. He came home, the airport, they had a police escort, a 12-car police escort, took him to the mayor's office. The mayor congratulated him, went to TV stations, and it was like the Mardi Gras.
I wonder, is it because I'm black?
Then there was the restaurant incident, wasn't
yes,
it?
Yes, Muhammad came back from Rome with a gold medal on his neck, and he said, Rudy, let's go up, just go uptown to get us some dinner. So we were out at this particular restaurant, and in those days, it was an all-white restaurant, and Muhammad walked in and says, I'm Cassius Clay, let me go mail. They said, we know who you are, but because of your race, color, we can't serve. He said, what? He said, come on, we got a motor scooter, rode uptown. He threw it into the river and said, it's not worth a damn. I thought being a Liberty champion, they would respect me and serve me some food, but it's not worth a damn. So he's doing it in the Ohio River. He felt proud.
So somewhere down here in the Ohio River.
The famous gold medal is in the Ohio River, sir.
You do me like that, but you keep on holding me back. Keep on putting your foot on me.
For over 20 years, the BBC's Harry Carpenter enjoyed a special relationship with Muhammad Ali. It was a roller coaster ride which remains unique.
I was a very lucky man to have had this remarkable relationship with Ali over many, many years, almost 20 years. I could walk into his camp and I would know that he would give me the interview I wanted. I knew that he would say the things that I would want him to say. I never had to tell him what to say. He knew what to say. He knew exactly what I wanted. And there was never any acrimony between us. There was never any payment between us. We had all those interviews, all that wonderful stuff that he did for BBC television. That all came free. He did it because he liked us.
Lucky to be with me taking this interview. Most people I don't take much time with. But you all fellows are so nice, I'll give you this time.
That's very kind of you. We appreciate it.
Yeah.
I shook up the world! Oh, I shook up the world!
Rumble, young man, rumble!
You better back
away! Who's the prettiest fighter in the
You better catch yourself!
What did you say, Sergeant? You mean the plane is gonna crash? Be a prayer, recite a Bible verse, do something religious.
I'll take a selection.
Well, we're gonna have a little old game of English croquet, and I'm gonna play the world champ. I'm an Englishman, I don't even know how to play it.
Well, so. Yes, I know all about this game. I've been playing this game ever since I was a kid. No, you have to hit the peg.
Okay, take it back.
You must hit this.
Boom. Oh, yeah.
Well, nice playing with you, and the next time I challenge you to a game of croquet, I understand you have a nice place over there where we can play called Roehampton.
That's right. That is the great place.
It?
Exactly right.
Roehampton.
That's a date.
Well, I will be there to beat you in one.
Okay.
All right, let's go over there. We'll pick up our ball.
Who did this guy ever fight?
Who?
Yeah.
Clay?
Yeah.
He boxed London?
London. Boxed who?
Peter Cooper. I mean, what's
Peter
his name?
Peter Cooper? You can lick Peter Cooper.
What about that night, the middle of the night, when you turned up at Sonny Liston's own home?
Oh, yes. That was in Denver, Colorado. We went to his house one night before the signing of the contract in Denver, and I drove my bus in his front yard and told him that I blowed my air horn, woke him up, and he came out in the middle of the night in his underclothes, his robe, and he had a big stick, and he said, you get out of my yard. And I said, you big ugly bear, you. I'm gonna see you tomorrow for the signing, and I'm gonna knock you out in eight.
I don't think you know what you're talking about. You don't know a thing about it.
Listen, has never proved that he could go 15 rounds.
Ah, what are you
Where
talking
Clay
about?
Has.
Ah, you're out of your mind.
Let us see. Hard-working Mr. Dynamite.
Nobody much liked Sonny Liston. He didn't court popularity.
I think Liston is the greatest player we ever lived.
His lack of education and his earlier reputation as a man at odds with society made communication difficult. But without doubt, the boxing world and the public respected him as champion.
Hey, back, back.
You tell me how you think the fight will go, Sonny.
Oh, I think it's just will go
yep.
Like all the rest of them.
One round?
That's what I'm planning for.
The way K
Cassius Clay keeps trying to taunt you, you ignore it.
You ever been a kid when you start talking loud or singing loud or something to amuse yourself so that you won't get scared and run out?
This is what we call whistling in the dark.
Yeah, so that's what Clay does. But when the bell sounds and he comes to me, I don't know what he might do.
Clay has always said that his speed will beat the lumbering Liston. An American reporter reminded him that the Titanic was also faster than the iceberg. So far, nothing much in it. But from now on, it becomes one of the most extraordinary and puzzling fights of all time. Clay didn't want to come out for this round. He almost quit on his stool. He's complaining there's something in his eyes that he can't see properly. He believes it's something that's come off Liston's gloves. He's only in there now because Angelo Dundee, his trainer, shoved him out for the fifth and told him to get on with it. These are the worst 3 minutes Clay's ever had in the ring. It's the only time in his professional career that he could be accused of not wanting to fight. He may have something in his eyes. At the same time, he doesn't look like the eager young challenger who'll go through hell and high water to get the title. I'll swear that not one of us in that Miami Beach arena could have predicted what would happen next. There's always been doubt about Liston's real age. He claims he's 30. Suddenly, in this round, he looks 40. At this point, Liston claims he can hardly lift his left arm to throw a punch. 100 different theories have been advanced as to why this fight ended so strangely. Most of them are libelous. The most charitable theory is that Liston was telling the truth and that his shoulder was bad. A more cynical explanation is that he knew by this time he was in for a beating and he couldn't face it.
Sonny, 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 what happened? Get up, the bell rung. Sonny, get up. Don't quit. Sonny said, my mother did not raise no fool. I'm gonna stay right here on my stool.
Sonny, how much did it hurt you inside when you lost that title?
I can't more than words can explain.
The bear couldn't hurt me. The bear couldn't even get a good lick. I'm so pretty. Oh, I'm so great. Oh, I'm so great. Oh, I'm so great.
It's just over a week since Cassius Clay won the heavyweight title. People all over the world are still talking about this amazing character.
I feel real good. I've always said that I was the uncrowned champion, and I always had the feeling that I was the champion. As a matter of fact, I knew I was the champion before the fight.
So this is Joe Bostic at WLIV in New York, and an aside here and there about that interesting development up in Boston where Sonny Liston and Cassius Clay will settle their small differences, and differences that have grown out of the fact that both of them want the same thing, namely the heavyweight championship of the world.
There are still a lot of people, both here and in America, who simply can't believe that the fight was fair and above board. What do you say about that, Cass?
Well, a lot of people say that the fight was fixed, it was funny, only because of the shock of losing all of their money. But,
Cassius has it, Sonny wants it. Sonny had it, Cassius took it. Now, they want to even the score. Sonny would like that a lot.
You have a fellow over there who knocked me down, and I don't like it, and I haven't forgot it, and it really embarrassed me, and I want to show the world that he's nothing either, and I want to give him a shot at my crown. That Henry Cooper, I want him right there in London, England.
Well, Henry Cooper is keener than ever to have a shot with you, so,
I'm looking for him, too.
Britain met him for the first time in 1963. He wasn't champion yet, but he was already world famous, the man who predicted the round and always seemed to be right. He was here to fight Henry Cooper.
He caught me in the corner and he hit me with a left hook.
And it was a hard one.
Oh,
was the end of the fourth round, and he hit him about 2 seconds before the end of the round with a left hook. Clay took one chance too many, and he still doesn't know where he is. He's still half out, Clay. They're working furiously on him in the corner. Angelo Dundee, his trainer. He really is giving him a talking to. Now this crowd at Wembley are beginning to bay for a Cooper win. Clay on the floor at the end of the fourth, and now fighting to preserve his professional life here against Henry Cooper. Oh, and now Cooper's left eye is really in a shocking state. It really is now. And I think Tommy Little will have to stop this, because Cooper's eye is really in an absolutely appalling state.
Cooper, of course, couldn't go on. To this day, we still like to play the game of pretending what might have happened if Cooper had hit him a little earlier in the fourth. What might have been didn't matter. Clay had said five rounds, and five rounds it was, whether we liked it or not. Henry had given Clay his final test. I don't think any of us, maybe not even Clay, imagined that he'd be world champion in another 8 months.
Cass, who's that you've got there with you in the New York studio?
Come here, Sam. I got the British press here. Mm-hmm. This is Sam Cooke. As you can see, like me, he's awful pretty. And we are here now working on a record called The Gang's All Here.
Would you like to give us a preview of this disc?
We'll give him a sample.
Come on, let's give him a preview.
We'll do a lot better if we had the music here with us.
All right, we're going to do it. We'll
try now.
Hey, the gang's all here. Join in the fun. Hey, the gang's all here. We're gonna swing as one.
Do it again now.
Hey, the gang's all here. Join in the fun. Hey, the gang's all here. We're gonna swing as one. Hey, the gang's all here. Join in the fun. Hey, the gang's all here. We're gonna swing as one. Yeah.
How you like that?
I'll see you guys later.
All right, Sam. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much, Cass.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
The sun is fantastic. I'm not used to this sort of weather.
From the movies I see, England seems to be a rather dreary place. You know, damp, cool.
We survive.
Yeah, I see. I don't guess you live to be this old for nothing.
This is what we call filling the gas tank. In other words, getting up early in the morning, coming out, getting your legs in shape, getting your wind. And we get up every morning. This is the most important thing about a fighter. You see those large boots he have on? We travel with those because lifting the weights fill up, build the ankles and the legs and everything. When you take those off and put those boxing trunks on, you have a little, two little invisible wings, I would say. These are the part that the ladies and gentlemen and the kids in the world don't see. Average fella don't even want to get up in the morning.
He's pretty well togged up there. He's got a lot of gear on.
Well, he got a rubber suit under that sweatsuit, you know, by him not fighting but once a year, you know. He get a little tummy and then get a little large in the back there a little bit. And that sweatsuit sweat it down. When he take it off, he probably have a quart of water under there. Those are things that people don't see.
Pop, pop, hooking, jabbing and left hooking, jabbing and left hooking. Yeah, I'm a pretty fighter.
I'm William Cutchins, president of Brown Williams Tobacco Corporation, manufacturers of Cools and Viceroys, and also one of the owners of the ABC television station in Louisville, Kentucky.
We offered him a $10,000 bonus for signing a contract, where we paid him a salary, because after all, we didn't know what he could earn. And we wanted to guarantee him some form of security. At the same time, he also got 50% of his purses.
It keeps a man relaxed when he's got good backers. He can know he's gonna always get a good meal that's gonna be paid for, training camp to stay in, and sparring partners will be paid, and everything that he needs.
The champ! The biggest sporting man ever been held on the
champ!
I'm the champ! Yeah! I'm the biggest thing in this president! I'm the king! Queen of the Queen of the Beatles! 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 The Beatles!
If people begin to identify with Cassius,
and the type of image he was creating, they were going to have trouble out of these Negroes, because they'd have Negroes walking around the street saying, I'm the greatest, and also Negroes who were not saying that they were nonviolent.
Why do you insist on being called Muhammad Ali now?
Well, that's the name given to me by my leading teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That's my original name. That's a black man named Cassius Clay, was my slave name. I'm no longer a slave.
He's surrounded by people who pretend to be for him, but are actually using his position to exploit him.
With American soldiers dying in Vietnam, the new non-militant champion could hardly hope for popularity. He was no longer the genial buffoon. Despite his troubles, Muhammad Ali couldn't resist a bit of the old malarkey. With collar and honey, he set out to trap the big, ugly bear.
The bear got loose. You know, I beat him the first time. I thought we'd put him in the cage after that, but he still got loose. He was training, and he was out on the loose again. So we went and bought us a bear collar. We tried to catch him. We bought some honey. We laid the honey on the sidewalk, but we couldn't trap the bear. 20 or 30 policemen took the bear in.
Treating Liston with his usual contempt. Gloves down, look at those hands, right down. This is foolish, his hands right down to his thighs and just using his feet to keep out of trouble. His punches until he gets within range. In the first fight, he was trying to throw him from all distances and all angles. And he wore him. And he's over. I don't know what happened there. He hardly seems to touch him, and Liston can't get up. And Clay must have won. It must be over. And Jersey Joe Walker doesn't know what to do. Nobody knows what the count was, and Walcott's puzzled and Clay's waiting to get at him, and they've started without the referee's instructions. Jersey Joe Walcott says it's all over. Stop. This is fantastic. This is fantastic. I've never seen a finish like it in my life.
Can you remember the punch he caught you with?
It was the right hand.
I suppose it must have hurt you.
Well, I wouldn't say it hurt me.
Don't you think you could have beaten the count then?
Yes, if he'd got away from him over. Did you see the fight? Well, how can a man get up when he's standing over you? If you get up, you're going to have to use your hand, right? So how am I going to protect myself and get up too?
They're sending my managers a phony, Angelo Dundee. They're sending Liston's people a phony. They're sending the state commissioners phony. And couldn't nobody pull no fix before the world like that.
215 pounds coming in on 200.
Somebody said it was half karate and half punch. It wasn't. That was just pure. There was no karate back in Jack Johnson's days.
Chop, the game is alive. What if these things will be dead? The reporters got something to write about.
That chop right? That chop right? When I tell them about that chop right?
The peanut man's gonna make money. The popcorn man's gonna make money. The beer man's gonna make money. That town is alive.
I am inclined to feel that he is a little ungrateful. The boy would never have had a chance. He would never have been able to get where he is if it hadn't been for this syndicate.
Everything in America that has been made the greatest has been painted and colored white. So, like Jesus is white, we have Santa Claus white, Tarzan, King of the Jungles, he's white, Miss America's white, Miss Universe is white, Miss World is white. When you go to heaven, you walk on a milky white way. Before you go to heaven, you wash the lamb blood, he's white as snow, he's white, they teach you.
says the boasting and the predicting are over. But when the public's eye is on him, he can seldom resist playing to the gallery. And even when he's meeting old friends for the umpteenth time, if a camera or microphone's around, he'll succumb.
I am the greatest.
Angelo, tell us, just what is it that makes him a great champion?
Well, actually, in training, he does hardly nothing. I mean, and that's a broad statement, but he doesn't work too hard in the gym. He just works to get condition. So one day, he hit a fellow a punch, and there was not even anything like a left uppercut. And I said, gee, when he slipped your punch and you hit him with a left uppercut, I thought it was beautiful. And he says, yeah, it was pretty good, wasn't it? And then he started using the left uppercut to effect.
You've got to get to him by a roundabout way. This is the way through to his mind.
Angel hair is white, angel food cake is white, and devil food cake is dark, and Mary had a little lamb, his feet as white as snow. So everything, the greatest so far, has been white, and these are just falsehood.
Our families freed, way back there, we freed the slaves in our families. But I'm sure that Cassius is probably great-grandparents and some of my relatives. They were probably the owners of Cassius's great-grandfather.
Job of the world!
The white man has told you time and again he didn't want you, he said.
Every Sunday, he tunes in and listens to the man he calls the messenger, the American Muslim leader, Elijah Muhammad.
Stamp upon you, swing you up to a limb and lynch you.
Face of you.
Of all people, he had to say the name Cassius Clay. Of all people, one of my own kind, a so-called Negro, he's determined to continually call me Clay, knowing that that was a slave name, knowing that that's no longer my name.
People all around me, and they're all in fear. They don't seem to want me, but they won't admit.
And I predict that Terrell will catch hell at the sound of the bell.
Ernie Terrell thinks he's a championship fighter, but when he meets me, he will fall 20 pounds lighter. He may come in the ring
looking clean and neat, but if he's not cool, they'll carry him out by his feet. Now, I'm not saying this just to be funny,
but I'm fighting Ernie because he needs the money. I decided to let him make a little bread, but the catch is I must whip his head. I understand he wants to stand toe-to-toe.
And with me, trade blow for blow.
But if he's hip, he'll take a dip because I plan to
bust his lips.
And after the fight, Terrell will know he was in a scuffle
because he couldn't master the Ali shuffle. Surprised you, huh? Surprised you, huh? That's a long prediction, huh?
Having hard times, there's no love to be found.
These are some of the most astonishing scenes that we've ever seen in a World Heavyweight Championship fight. The chances he takes. Telling Terrell to fight. Come on, fight, he says. Open up. This is when Muhammad Ali is at his least sportsmanlike. Call me Muhammad Ali, not Cassius Clay. What's my name? He's asking him, what's my name in the middle of a World Heavyweight Championship fight? Terrell's right eye, very bad. What's my name? He says it over and over again. I want to know my name. And Terrell goes for him after the bell.
Oh dear, this is not sport.
But he completely changed his opinion about Tyrrell overnight. Well, it might have been, as he said, that he cooled down, but I think it's rather more likely that the people behind him, who are the Muslims, and in particular Herbert Mohammed, who's now his manager, I think it's very likely that they got hold of him overnight and said, look, you're destroying what little good public image you've got left, and you've got to change this, and you've now got to give Tyrrell a little credit.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Muhammad Ali has just refused to be inducted into the United States Armed Forces.
Why me, a man who pays the salary of at least 50,000 men in Vietnam, a man who can pay in two fights for three bomber planes?
Do you all want to see me fighting? They don't see me. They'd rather for me to preach.
Muhammad Ali said he had no quarrel with the Viet Cong. He wouldn't join up. America turned on him.
What about your unpatriotic remarks that you made?
That will be straightened out with the government or whoever I have to face when it comes to
Mr. Clay, Muhammad Ali, sir. Mr. Muhammad Ali, either yes, one. You said you were the people's champion?
Yes, sir.
Do you think that you're acting like a people's champion?
Yes, sir.
You'll find out that I divorced my first wife because she was conformed to the Muslim faith.
I've been off 3 1/2 years, 35 pounds overweight, and get a 6-week notice. So there's no time for joking, playing, or clowning. And when that bell rang, the world will be waiting.
A remarkable achievement to come back into shape to meet a top contender in only 7 weeks. And here's the reception for the return of Muhammad Ali.
And I'm sure that if Quarry can win, he'll be a great, 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 great hero.
Hours ago, I left the ringside of Madison Square Garden, New York, carrying with me the videotape recording of one of the most extraordinary fights of all time. Now I'm in London to share with you the boxing experience of a lifetime, the amazing multi-million dollar battle of champions between Joe Frazier and Cassius Clay for the undisputed heavyweight championship of the world.
About 6 weeks ago, you said that you would make a prediction as to what would be the outcome of the fight tonight.
The champion comes out into this vast arena, packed with people.
But all Joe Frazier's relying on is a couple of good hooks.
Joe, I know you don't like to talk at a moment like this, but you're getting $2.5 million.
What are you trying to tell me?
This is the biggest fight of all time, and it could be one of the best of all time.
My prediction is Joe Frazier in round 6. And it's impossible for Joe Frazier to outbox, outpoint Muhammad Ali. He'll have to knock me out to win, and that's still impossible.
Here's Muhammad Ali, the man who tries tonight to regain the title that he never lost in the ring.
He's just like a machine. He just keep coming, looking for hooks, and he everybody hit him. He's hit so easy, he gets angry if you miss him.
Show me what you'll be doing, Wally.
The perfect match because they're both unbeaten.
Oh, he'll be coming in, you know, and I'll be taking my time and keeping my distance on my toes, staying in arm range. I'm taller than he, and pop, pop. Get a little too close, grab him, tie him up, you know, clinch him, walk with him, you know, just walk him all around.
He got his little phony ways about him, you know what I mean? But as far as I'm concerned, he's all right with me.
This contest is for the final determination of the heavyweight championship of the world. Why don't you ever have any doubts that somebody
might
beat you?
No doubt. How can I lose with the stuff I use?
And there's the bell. He picks his man off from the distance. And Clay looks out and says, he didn't hurt me. How can a man afford to do this? Here he is in the most important fight of his life. And he's treating the man with contempt. And the
former champion now under heavy pressure again. And it's noticeable that the talking has stopped. Clay's got his work cut out now with this fight, and he knows it. And Frazier this time snarls back at Clay as Clay catches him to the head. I don't know what he said, but obviously he was showing contempt for the punches. Frazier gets caught as he comes in. He's got a few bumps around his eyes now, Frazier. And of the two, Frazier is the more marked on the face now. And Frazier grins. He puts his hands down and he laughs. And he says, your punches aren't hurting me. And still he comes on. But he takes them as he comes in. That's a tremendous shout from Muhammad Ali. He's got the crowd going with him, and he motions to Frazier and says, listen, they're rooting for me. Good left hook from Clay. One of the rare left hooks that he uses. Now he's giving Frazier a working over, and Frazier goes back for the first time. Round nine, and Clay forced Frazier to retreat, and he retreated because he was getting hurt. And Clay beckons him back. Frazier really goes after him, and he's got him with a left hook. He's done it once too often. Clay's in trouble. Round 11. He's hurt. He nearly went down. Here's the first great climax of this fight. The left hooks are thundering in. And Clay's in trouble, and he makes a face. It's a big round for Frazier. And he's hurt again, and he almost goes over. Clay's in real trouble. Now he really needs to move. Now is he foxing or is he really hurt? He's hurt. Tremendous round for Frazier. The bell's coming up. Oh, and Clay's play acting again. He pretends he's hurt. And Clay was hurt, but not hurt as much as he was trying to make out. And Angelo Dundee shouts at him and says, what are you doing? Now he gets to work again. He's coming back. Oh, there he is! The left hook! Frazier's at last caught up with him. Tremendous left hook, and Clay is fighting for survival.
A celebrity or any so-called great person have obligation to fulfill, to take defeat like a man so they can take their defeats when they have them, because we all are going to have various defeats in life, whether it be loss of loved ones or wealth or titles, and many people just can't stand these pressures and they crack up on them. And when a man can come through this after so many years of victory and been so supreme in his field and able to handle the defeat also victorious, then this makes him a bigger man.